Hey, if you're thinking about buying the Lifeline 2, you've come to the right place. In this video, I'm going to give an overview of all the current features, including a walkthrough of the user interface, some pros and cons, and my recommendations on whether or not you should get the phone. So the Lifeline is a basic phone that's designed to be used as little as possible. Basically, that means it can call and text, and it has a few simple tools. But the philosophy of the company behind the phone is that it won't include things that will keep you hooked with endless scrolls, like social media and news and things like that. If you want to learn more about digital minimalism, I have a playlist that I'll link at the end of this video. All right, so the device itself comes in black and light gray. I obviously have the black version. The price is $299. This silicone case was an additional $25. Here's the Lifeline next to an iPhone 6S, just for a size comparison. In terms of the buttons and jacks, on the top, you've got the headphone jack and the power button. On the bottom, you've got the charging port and the microphone. And on the side, you've got the menu button and the up volume and down volume buttons. On the other side, underneath the case, is where you'll find the tray for the SIM card. The phone comes with a USB charging cable, but no charging block. It's got an e-ink touchscreen, which is the same as what you'd find on an Amazon Kindle or similar e-reader. And you'll see in a moment that the e-ink screen needs to refresh from time to time, which means that it just flashes blank for a split second as it transitions from one screen to the next. Having an e-ink screen also means that you get some ghosting or remnants of the previous screen, but that has not been an issue for me so far. The screen also has a backlight, which is good news for using it in the dark. When you order the Lifeline, you can ask for them to send you a SIM card or you can just use your own. And that's what I did with a Verizon SIM card. And you can check on their website to see if your carrier is compatible with the Lifeline. If you're in the US, you can also get a data plan directly from Lite that's supported by AT&T's network. You can still get the Lifeline if you live internationally, but again, I'd recommend checking out their website to double check compatibility. I do know that as of right now, the phone only supports a standard American English keyboard. All right, time for a walkthrough of the user interface. I know that other people have done much more in-depth versions that you can check out if you want more information after watching this video. All right, so this is the home screen, and at the top you can see the battery life indicator, the service indicator, and that's also where you'd see icons for a hotspot link or Bluetooth or anything like that. There's the clock in the middle, and that can also display the date if you want. And if you have a notification, so a text or a missed call, there will be a little asterisk by the clock like this. From this screen and from most screens in the phone, you can adjust the volume. The lowest level is called nothing, which means there's no sound, no vibration, and no screen indicator. The next level up is called vibrate only, which is pretty self-explanatory, and then you get several levels of ringer volume. If you press this circle button at the bottom here, it opens the phone and brings you to the central phone and contacts application. These are all grouped by your most recent interactions, but you can also search for contacts or conversations at the bottom. So if you open a conversation thread, you get the text and call history. So you can see texts and missed calls from either party along with the timestamp. On each of these conversations, you have the options to compose a new text message, to make a phone call, or to exit out. And you can see there, that's about the time delay for a lot of the functions on this phone. So if you were to make a phone call, this is what it would look like. Now you have the options to access the keypad, to put it on speaker, or to mute the phone, or to hang up down here. I will say that I've tested this out with standard Apple wired headphones that have a microphone, and that works really well for phone calls. It's actually how I prefer to talk on the phone. If you want to compose a new message, you hit compose, and then you can select who you want to send that to. And then you can search your contacts for a recipient, choose from the list, and then if you want to compose a group message, you can add a second recipient using this button, and then you can go to compose your text message. So just for a speed comparison, I'm going to show you how long it takes me to text the same sentence on both the Lifeline and my iPhone. So there is a slight delay with texting with the Lifeline, and the keys are really small, and so it's easy to hit the wrong key. Fortunately, if you do need to make an edit, you can move the cursor and select a different spot, backspace, and type again. But there is no autocorrect currently on the Lifeline. When you're ready to send it, press the send, and then it becomes part of the conversation thread with that person. Now, group messages are typically labeled by the initials of the people in the call, but you do have the option of renaming a group or even muting notifications from that group. A couple things for text: pictures don't come through, but you can have it set up to forward pictures to your email address. Emojis kind of come through, but they don't always show up super well. And I found that contact cards sent from iPhones don't work at all.
one.
I also just found out recently that you can include accents in your text messages. Okay, now for the tools. So to access the toolbox, you can press the side button over here. So right now I have all the tools that are currently available loaded onto the phone, and you can actually choose not to have them if you don't want. So phone would take you back to that list of calls and texts like I showed before. Alarm is a basic alarm and you can set one at a time. And when you're ready to set it, you just press the alarm button and then it's good to go. The calculator is just a simple calculator and can perform basic functions. And then the music app. I'll show you in a second, but music is all loaded through the dashboard, which is the online portal for the Lifeline. These songs are all downloaded to my phone, and if you want to play one, you see the controls there, name of the artist, name of the song. The phone does have a speaker it can play out of, but again, there's also the headphone jack and then Bluetooth capabilities. For podcasts, there's a thread of all the most recent podcasts. You can check out the podcast that you're subscribed to, which again happens through the dashboard. And so you can look at specific episodes. When you're on Wi-Fi, you can download episodes to then play back later.
It is time for another episode of the Dumb Phone Show, and today we have Sam Reid with us. He's a content creator from the Studio Review.
So when you pause it, you can see the timestamp there. I will say that if you navigate away from this for a certain amount of time, for example, if you try to come back to it the next day, it will not save your place in the podcast. And then last but not least is settings, and I mainly want to highlight airplane mode, notifications. You can change the way you get notifications, you can change the sounds. So that's my current ringtone. And my current text message sound. And the sound I have for my new alarm. Here you can also turn off that asterisk that I mentioned earlier. I'll skip preferences for now. In terms of Bluetooth and Wi-Fi, here's where you can connect with Bluetooth devices. I know they're working out some bugs on connecting to certain cars and other products. For Wi-Fi, you can choose to turn it on or off. And then when you turn it on, it'll search for networks. And you can choose a network and enter a password. In my experience so far, I don't think you can connect to Wi-Fi networks that have a login page, places like Dunkin' Donuts or Starbucks or even hotels. I think it's just simple password protected home Wi-Fi networks. And then finally, the personal hotspot, you can turn that on and it'll give you the name of the network and then the password. I've found that to be pretty effective so far. You may have noticed that there's no voicemail tool, and what you have to do is just call your own number and listen to your voicemail like you would on a landline or on an old school cell phone.
To listen to your messages, press 1.
I know you shouldn't base your purchase on the promise of future updates, but I would be remiss if I didn't mention the navigation feature, which is set to release this week. My friend Jose had a conversation with Joe from the Lifeline team about the navigation feature, and you can watch that conversation by clicking up here. Joe also mentioned in that conversation that one of the things coming down the pipeline is potentially a voice-to-text feature, which is something that I would be really excited about. Okay, so this is the dashboard. You can import contacts. I was able to import mine pretty smoothly from Apple. You've got device info, which just includes serial number, model, software version, and then the toolbox. So this is where you can actually add or remove the applications from the phone. So as you can see, the only mandatory ones are phone and settings. The rest can be added or removed. So for music, it actually functions a lot like an MP3 player. So you need to have the files on your computer to add. And then once you upload them, they'll sync with your phone. So as far as I know, you can only have one playlist, but you can arrange it, you can add songs, you can delete songs. And as you can see here, I've only used about 20% of the 1 gigabyte of storage. And then lastly, for podcasts, you have to actually search and add podcasts to your list of podcasts, and then they'll show up here, and episodes from these podcasts will refresh onto your phone. So obviously when navigation becomes available, I'd be able to add it through the dashboard. All right, so let's talk pros and cons. First off, I would consider the price a pro. I know a lot of people have complained that the price seems pretty steep, but if the alternative is buying a brand new iPhone, this is actually super affordable, especially from such a young company. Another pro is that Lite gives you the option to pay for a carbon offset, which means that you can elect to pay an additional $3 to offset the carbon footprint of this product from production all the way through end of life. Another pro is just the look and feel of this device. I really like the way it feels in my hands, the way it looks to hold it. And I would throw in there too, durability. So far I've had no issues with the structural integrity of this phone. Here's one pro that started off as a con. I found myself in several situations where I've wanted to take pictures and haven't been able to because there's no camera. But I think that's a pro because it's really allowed me to be present in the moment in a way that I haven't been able to with a smartphone. A huge pro that you hear people bring up for e-readers is being able to read the screen in broad daylight, and I would say that absolutely holds true for the Lite phone. There's no glare or difficulty seeing at all. On such a small phone, the battery isn't that big, but I haven't had any issues making it through a normal day with calling, texting, and even using tools like music and the hotspot. And the hotspot has been another huge pro for me that has come in handy a number of times. Last two pros, one on a personal basis, I have been able to avoid this habit of doom scrolling through Instagram and Twitter and social media apps that sucked up so much of my time before. And secondly, I just want to give a shout out to the Lite phone team and the company behind this phone, because I think what they're doing is really good and they have really great customer service and have been really responsive to emails and requests for support. All right, as for cons, I would say first off, texting and some pretty basic functions do take a lot longer than they would on a smartphone. And I would say the flip side of that is that it causes me to be a lot more intentional and thoughtful about what I'm saying and how much I actually need to say. Another con that I mentioned before is that there are just some incompatibility issues with iPhones. Someone tried to send me a contact card from their iPhone and I had to apologize and say, hey, can you please type out the number? But at the end of the day, not a huge deal. This one's less of a con about the Lite phone and more of just something I miss about my smartphone, which is Smart Pay. I can't tell you how many times I've gotten to the checkout of the grocery store and realized I don't have my wallet on me and have been able to use my smartphone. And so obviously that's not something that this basic phone currently supports. There are a handful of cons for me with the texting interface, and that's just because as far as I know, there's no caps lock, there's no autocorrect, and there's no copy and paste. And like I mentioned before, currently no voice to text, but I hope that that will change in the near future. And I will say that there are a number of bugs that the company is aware of, but they're working through. So one of those is if you're typing out a text message and you get a call, once that call's over, your text won't be there anymore when you get back. But I reached out to them. They told me that they're aware of it and they're hoping to work that out in future updates. So real quick, I want to give you my take on the Lite phone and then my recommendation on whether or not you should get it. So all in all, I would say it's been really great. I found that I have more free time to do things like reading when I normally would have been scrolling through my phone. I would say I'm more present when I'm around people and I'm less distracted when I'm doing things like driving, to be honest. And this part is huge. I will say that there are workarounds for the majority of things that I would have previously needed to do on my smartphone. Now, some of those things do require additional devices. For example, for running, I'm about to purchase a low-end Garmin GPS watch just so I can track the distance for my runs. For my car, I'm currently using an old TomTom GPS from like 2010, but it gets the job done and gets me where I need to go. And of course, if you want to take pictures, it's helpful to have a camera that isn't part of your phone. Some of the other workarounds are just text or call based. So one of the ones that I'm most excited about, again, I found out from my friend Jose, and I'll link his video up here, but it's a text service where you can text them your starting address and your destination address, and they will send you via text turn by turn directions. There are also numbers that you can save in your phone, and when you call, there will be a recording of the weather forecast for the next several days for your area. And I don't know if you guys remember ChaCha, but that was a texting service that you could text in the mid 2000s to ask questions, kind of like Google, and they'd text you back the top search result. Unfortunately, I looked it up and ChaCha shut their doors in 2016. And finally, I'll just say that when I made the switch, I did keep my old iPhone to be able to use on Wi-Fi. And I can also use the desktop versions of things like Instagram and YouTube and even iMessage by using the email address associated with my Apple ID. For me, the biggest switch is that the smartphone is no longer a part of my everyday carry. It stays at my desk and it doesn't come with me everywhere I go. Okay, so here's my official recommendation. I think that you should get this phone if you're ready to stop spending tons and tons of meaningless time on your phone. Like I said before, the Lite phone is designed to be used as little as possible to free you up to live your life. And I think that's incredible. I'd also recommend this phone if you're a parent looking for a basic phone for your kid. Now, I don't have kids of my own, but I do work with high school and middle school students, and I would feel totally comfortable giving this phone to a middle schooler. Now, I would say that I would not recommend getting this phone if there are features on your smartphone that you are dependent on, whether that's for work or your personal life. There are just things that the Lite phone cannot do and frankly is not designed to do. I'd also say don't get this phone if you're not ready to make a significant adjustment from your smartphone. I'd be lying if I said this wasn't a huge change and it takes some getting used to. And finally, I would not recommend this phone for an elderly parent. I know that some people are looking for basic phones for someone that might be older or maybe less tech savvy. And while the Lite phone is definitely a basic phone, I would just say that the screen size and the responsiveness of the touchscreen would probably be a little tricky for someone who is older. But that that wraps it up for this review. Please let me know in the comments if you have any questions that I wasn't able to cover. And once again, definitely go check out Jose's channel because he has a lot more content about current and future features for the Lifeline. I'll see you soon.